Is our system of money in the United States just one big scam?
Well, actually, that's the short answer, but that's not an answer that people really can understand, because all of us, including myself, we were raised with the concept that our money system was very sound. It was part of the United States government. We had the Treasury looking after it, and we had the Federal Reserve System looking after it, and all those things. So, you know, we were raised thinking that it was the kind of a system that was stable, and it was put in place to protect us and to stabilize the economy and all of that sort of thing. And so when somebody comes along and says it's a scam, you know, that's so far off the track that most people just cannot even consider that's true. But nevertheless, that is the short answer, and that's the answer I came to after quite a bit of research. I spent about probably 7 years of intensive research trying to figure out what the Federal Reserve System is and what it has done to our money system, and I came inexorably to that conclusion. And the reason I say it is this. If you back off and look at the Federal Reserve, and that's really the topic of my book, The Creature from Jekyll Island, is a second look at the Federal Reserve System. When you look at what the Federal Reserve is, it's not a government agency, it's a cartel. Believe it or not, our money system is operated, controlled totally by a cartel. No different than an oil cartel or a banana cartel. Happens to be a banking cartel. And the people that created it met in secret back in 1910 on a little island off the coast of Georgia. It's called Jekyll Island. And that's the reason I called my book The Creature from Jekyll Island. It's a real island. And back in those days, it was completely owned by a small group of billionaires from New York City, people like J.P. Morgan, William Rockefeller, and their business associates. This is where their families went to spend the cold winter months. It's a beautiful place. You can visit it today and see those mansions. And, of course, you would have to visit that big clubhouse that's still standing. That's where they met. And for a whole week, they sat around a table there on Jekyll Island in secret, told nobody they were going. For years afterwards, they denied that they went. They even changed their names when they took the trip, all kinds of secrecy. And they sat around a table, and they created the banking cartel that would control the nation's money supply. They took it back to Washington after they were all done and gave it to the politicians. They took off the name cartel across the top and wrote in the phrase Federal Reserve Act. They passed it into law. And now all of us are required by law to live under the conditions of a banking cartel that was completely drafted in private and in secret by the banks themselves. And like any other banking or any other cartel, whether it's a banking cartel or a banana cartel or an oil cartel, whatever, the whole purpose of these organizations is to further the objective of the members of the cartel. That's it, period, nothing else. So if you wonder why in recent months that during this financial crisis that all of the money that's being created out of nothing, these billions and trillions of dollars, you may have noticed, where is it going?
Yeah.
It's going to the banks.
Yes, yes.
Well, of course it's going to the banks because the banks are making the decisions. This is a banking cartel. And once you understand what it is, you realize that this whole system of bailouts and all of these, this quantitative easing and all of these fancy names they give to it, is nothing but legalized plunder of the American taxpayer, because all of that money comes out of our pockets either directly in the form of taxes or indirectly in the form of inflation. And that's where most of the action is going to go on, is through inflation. So yes, it is a scam. It's a scam by which a very powerful but very smart group of people who dominate the banking industry have figured out how to get into the pocketbooks of the average American and make them like it, because they're told that it's all for the best of America. So if that isn't a scam, I don't know what is.
I hear that. You know, these days I find myself constantly going back and referring to your book, The Creature from Jekyll Island. I'll watch the news, and then I'll check your book, and there it is. You know, a lot of what you talked about. It truly is alarming that a lot of what you predicted in that book, you know, which was published, what, 17 years ago, is now coming true. For example, you know, Chapter 2, the title, the name of the game is Bailout. I mean, how in the world were you able to see all of this coming more than 17 years ago?
Well, it really wasn't very difficult. It's just a matter of seeing what they were already doing And also, it's a matter of understanding what they were. As I just said a moment ago, once you understand that this is a banking cartel, and that the whole purpose of this cartel is to further the interests of the banks, once you understand that and really get your mind around it, then it's pretty easy to predict what these people are going to do, regardless of what happens. They're going to do those things which fatten the pocketbooks of the banking fraternity. And it was designed back in 1910 on that meeting, in that meeting on Jekyll Island. They talked about how this thing would work, why they were doing it, and one of the objectives was to bail them out because they knew the system they were putting together was not sustainable, would go on for a long time, but they knew it eventually would come unglued, or they felt it could come unglued. It always had previously in history. When you create money out of nothing, all of a sudden, you know, the money supply is completely removed from anything of tangible value. And so if people can create money out of nothing, as they do through the Federal Reserve System, you know what they're going to do? They're going to create money out of nothing. And they're going to create more of it and more of it and more of it until finally the supply just floods through the economy, and it's much greater than the goods and services that chase after it, and you've got this thing called inflation. And eventually that has a payoff. It's like giving somebody cocaine. Eventually they need more and more of it, and finally they have so much of it it's going to kill them. And so they go into a coma, and then you call in the drug pusher and says, I know how to fix this guy, let's give him some more cocaine. So they knew from history that these systems always collapse, and they figured down the line this one was going to collapse too. So the question was, what to do about it? Just stand around and let it fall? No. Let's make it appear like a government agency. Let's get the government involved as a partner. Let's get these politicians committed to bail us out using taxpayers' dollars. It was all decided way back in 1910 and 1913. So I knew that. And I also knew about certain laws of economics, which were pretty obvious from even a high school kid that spends a little time looking at the history of money and banking throughout history. That's just very simple history. Banks always get into partnership with government so they can plunder the people. And the economic system always falls apart as a result of it. That's happened over and over and over again. So once you just have a few little facts like that in mind, it's not difficult to see where the system is going. It's just like looking at a graph. You've got a bunch of dots, and if you've got three dots lined up in a row, one for this year, one for the year before, and one for the year before that, and they're all in a straight line, you don't have to be a rocket scientist to lay a ruler on those three dots and project where the whole thing is headed. Yeah. Unless there are some drastic changes, you know, in the way things are unfolding, we're going to go exactly where we're headed. So way back in 1994, when I wrote the book, I laid that mental ruler on the graph, and I could see where we were when the Federal Reserve System was created. I could see where we were also in 1994 when I wrote the book, and I just projected into the future, and voila, that's exactly where we are now.
Yeah.
So it didn't take an awful lot of brains to do that.
Well, there weren't too many people who were putting it together back then, I'll say that, at least not out publicly. But, you know, most people still don't understand. You know, you were talking about the cartel idea, that the Federal Reserve is this big cartel. Of course, anybody knows that the more business you have with a cartel, the more danger that you're in. And many of us don't fully understand that our money, the very money that we hold, that we save, that we spend, may be one of the most volatile and dangerous instruments that there could possibly be.
Well, money is, you know, it's right at the core of everything, isn't it? It's the medium of exchange, and just about anything you can think of that you want to either do or have somehow gets expressed in terms of money along the way. And you have to either pay people to do the things for you that you want them to, or you pay them to give you the things that you want them to give you. In other words, money is a measure of the degree to which you can command the services of other people. So it's power, isn't it? Money is power. And, you know, they say power is money. Well, it's kind of a circular thing, but those who have the ability to create money and to use it and to determine who gets it and what interest rates they pay for it, how readily it's available to expand their industries, those people sit at the very apex of power in a modern society. So when you look around and see who's running the world today, if you really understand what I've just said, you don't have to look necessarily in the halls of Congress or government. You look in the halls of money, because those are the people who can buy the politicians, who can support their campaigns, who can give them the media exposure they need to get the popular support to be elected and so forth. It's the money that really controls the politicians today. And once you understand that reality, then a lot of things begin to make sense, especially when you're looking at what's happening in the United States today. You know, we get the idea that Congress is somehow controlling those banks and making them toe the line and all that sort of thing. But, you know, it's really the other way around. If you really look, it's the bankers that are calling the tune and the congressmen are doing the jig. So anyway, that's just my observation, and it's certainly borne out by history. So yes, money is power, and I think the average American had better get a better handle on that if they want to make sure that they and their children and grandchildren continue to live in a free system.
Much in the same way that debt can be used against borrowers on a personal level, you know, to put them in sort of a subservient position with lenders, the same thing is happening with entire countries right now.
Absolutely, yes. This has been going on for a long time, especially what we call those third world countries. You know, they become sort of like welfare countries in a way. You know, in our own experience, we know of or have heard about families, these poor families that have been welfare families for a couple of generations. And, you know, you have to feel very sorry for them because the kids are brought up in this environment and they never have been given the idea that they have either a responsibility or an opportunity to be independent. They just think that living on welfare is the way it should be, and somebody's going to take care of them, and that somehow it's their right that somebody should take care of them. And so they're born into this, and there's not much chance of them ever breaking out of it. And so you have these welfare families. They go on from one generation to the next, and they'll never get out of it, or at least not easily. And nations are the same way, especially in today's world. A lot of nations have dictators, rulers. Sometimes they look like they're democratically elected people, but in all cases, almost all cases, these people are despots. They don't really care about the plight of the people of their country. All they care about is how well they live. Is their palace as big as the other guy's palace? Do they have a suite of rooms at the Waldorf Astoria when they go to the United Nations and participate in these meetings? Do they have limousine services? How many yachts do they have? All of these things. This is their focus, and they're all putting money away in Switzerland, you know, in case they get deposed and all that kind of thing. This is the reality of much of the world today. And so when they need money, they don't expect to earn it. They don't expect their economies to be productive. What they do is they go to some rich country or to the United Nations, and they say, well, we're ready for a loan or a grant. So the International Monetary Fund or the United Nations in some other form, World Bank or the United States, comes along and says, well, we'll give you a couple of million or a couple of billion dollars. And so it's supposedly to, you know, raise their standard of living and to help the poor people of those countries. But if you follow the money, you see that it goes directly into the pockets of the despots, mm-hmm. and it's used to pay off their cronies and their support mechanisms, their political supporters, and it's used to fatten their military so that they can put down any opposition. And a little bit of it might get through to the people, but not very much. And you can be sure that none of it gets through to those in their countries that object to what they're doing.
Wait a minute.
So it's used as a political weapon.
Were you just describing third world countries, or did you just describe the United States?
I think I was describing a universal condition, wasn't
yeah,
I?
Yeah.
But I was talking about third world countries because it's more obvious there. But you're absolutely right. The same thing tends to go on in advanced countries as well. The point of all that is, and it's in response to your question, that these nations, unfortunately, then become addicted to this free money coming from outside. Their economies are not designed to sustain themselves. They're designed to be supported by welfare, international welfare. And so they go from one leader to the next, one regime to the next, and the nations have no chance of ever breaking out of that. And so the leaders of these countries now are completely dependent, philosophically and politically, and certainly economically, on the source of the money, which is the United Nations. And so they're brought into this global political structure, and they, as long as they're good little boys and girls and do exactly as they're told, they continue to get the money. But if they break loose, then they're cut loose, and they literally wither on the vine.